Your Honor, I was ambassador of Greece to the U.S. back in the early 2000, from 2002 to 2005, and I had the honor and the pleasure to meet you at the Foreign Relations Committee of the Senate on many occasions. And I wish to thank you for all you are doing years now for Greece and Cyprus and for the rule of law also. My question is rather a point that I would like to raise since your lecture was dedicated to the security cooperation in the Eastern Mediterranean and with Turkey, you know, in the focus. You know, of course, that the main issue there is the delimitation of maritime zones between the countries of the area. And of course, you are aware of the challenges the Turkish policies vis-a-vis Cyprus and also Greece are posing against their rights according to the Law of the Sea Convention in the area. My point is the following. I would like to draw your attention to the fact that in recent months, Turkey extended its claims, completely unlawful claims, without any base on existing international law and the Law of the Sea, in the central Mediterranean, when its defense minister visited Libya last November. The sole purpose of that visit is to present the Libyans with a series of maps and drawings, trying to pull Libya to delimit its maritime zones, not with Greece, in the area of Crete and the Dodecanese complex, including the islands of Rhodes and Karpathos, and delimit those areas instead with Turkey. Such claims have no legal basis by any means. But I draw your attention that the policies and the provocations in the Aegean are recently extending also in possible arrangements that Greece has the right and has also the necessity to conclude with all its neighbors, including, of course, Libya, which, you know, is under special circumstances now. It's not in no position to conclude any international agreement. But such claims poses, you know, ambiguities, to say the least, and also threats for the future. So my very brief intervention on today's occasion is simply to draw your attention that the problem that we are facing now in the Eastern Mediterranean is gradually moving towards Central Mediterranean. And that also would be of great interest to American security interests, and also in defense cooperation terms with Greece, since, as you very well know, our defense cooperation agreement, the first one, was signed back in 1952, following our adherence to NATO. And since then, we have an excellent, you know, defense cooperation, which has a bright future, I can say, with all the governments that have passed all these years. So thank you again for your presentation, but I'd like to make that point in your presence today. Thank you again.
If I may, thank you, Ambassador. If I may, Senator, we have the wish of the Embassy of Turkey at the interview.
Thank you very much to IPLO for this invitation and for this event. And thank you for Senator Menendez to thorough and detailed explanations. Of course, I would need some minutes to answer the arguments put forward by Mr. Menendez, but it would be unfair for the other participants, so I will try to cut it very short. Three points. About the 15th of July, there have been a terrible attempt to Turkish democracy, and if it would be successful, we would be in disaster. So as a democratic country, we are taking only the countermeasures, and this country, the host country, Greece, which is the cradle of democracy, they also had painful years under the military junta in 1974, and they also know very well how military juntas and undemocratic, autocratic managements manage their country. So we are lucky enough not to live under such a military junta. The second point is, you talk about the Cyprus issue, and although it was very, very one-sided, you also talk about the influence of Ankara. You know, they are the guarantor powers under the international law. They are signed treaties for that, and the negotiations in Cyprus are under the umbrella of the United Nations. And so far, within 50 years, it has always been like this. And we came just 15 years ago, in 24th of April, just 15 years ago, there was a referendum on the island. And it was accepted by the Turkish community with almost 65% of the vote. And it was rejected by the Greek Cypriots with 75%. So we clearly see who plays the better role for reaching a sustainable solution there. And third point with regards to the S-400 and F-35, we are allies for decades, and Turkey has been the country with regards to the manpower which contributes to NATO second after the US, and we have tens of overlapping interests, and NATO itself has its stake in Turkish-American relations. But on the other hand, we have security concerns coming from our southern neighborhood, and we directly requested defense systems, and the US government did not give any response to our request, to our question. And another attractive proposal came from Russia. And they were sharing the technology as well. And we know very well that F-35s are operated in Norway, which are very close to Russian defense system. They are also operating in Israel. And in Syria, we have also Russian defense systems. So based on the facts, the incompatibility is not real. And we have suggested to the American administration to establish a working group to examine in detail the technical issues. The United States government is keeping its silence. So far, NATO has supported the idea, but we are waiting for a response from the United States administration. My question, sorry for the long arguments, but almost 60% of your presentation was focusing on Turkey, so I had to respond now. My question goes, you gave a little time to Israel, and their security concerns are, of course, very important, but they have to respect the security concerns of their neighborhood as well. There are Security Council resolutions based on 1967 borders. But now Jerusalem is the capital of Israel, recognized by the United States. The Golan Heights are now seen as part of Israel. Now there are plans for West Syria. So are we going to see new changes and new shapes conducted by US and Israeli decision makers in the future? This is very crucial. Your answer is very crucial if we are going to talk about Eastern Mediterranean.
Are we going to see, what is your final question? Are we going to see what?
New shapes in the Eastern Mediterranean. If we don't talk about the Mediterranean Sea, but also about the neighborhood. Thank you very much, and thank you for your patience.
Thank you very much. We are indeed very lucky this evening to have many representatives of foreign powers among us, and we are thankful to them. I know, for example, that there are two representatives of the Russian Federation here. We will have one more question, but very shortly expressed. And we will close. Please.
Russian. Embassy of the Russian Federation, thank you very much for the invitation and for this possibility to participate here. I would not want to go into discussion about what was said about Russian collusions or something like that. It's just, I would like to say, it's just baseless. But my question is, lately, the former president of the United States, Jimmy Carter, he was, as far as I remember, from the Democracy Party, right? So he said that if the United States has not spent so many trillion dollars for wars, there will be no infrastructure, there will be roads, there will be factories in the United States. It's his words, he said it later. So instead of speaking about other countries cooperating with each other in the region, and I mean cooperation between Russia and Turkey, Russia and Greece, recent China, maybe the United States should better think about its own infrastructure instead of spending money for military projects and something like that. So this is my question. Thank you.